Hello. We'll start here in a few minutes.
I wouldn't worry about the details, but I would just try the other house.
Talking so loud. You want me to mute it?
No, that's fine.
You guys can talk. That's fine. It's not. We're not okay. Starting it.
She is worried. Upstairs. Sorry. Yeah. You're so silly.
Thank you. Okay. Hello, everyone. We'll get started now. People can catch up. Oh man. Yeah. Hope everyone had a great weekend. Yeah. Okay. This week we are jumping into some bigger territory than we previously ended with last week. We were finishing up our monochromatic paintings. Or achromatic paintings, depending on if you used a color or not. And this week we're jumping into full color. And what we're looking for this week is every opportunity to really use color in as much saturation as possible. So we're going to talk a little bit about that and discuss maybe some approaches and some ideas. I already have my image transferred over, so I'm ready to go for this painting. The module portion is actually really short, but there are some things that I want to touch on and talk about as we move forward into this week's assignment. So let's switch this. Also to note, I will have my housekeepers coming by today. So at some point, they'll be probably vacuuming again, and I'll just mute the session and just continue to paint. Hopefully, I think that'll all line up. Okay, so this week, color still life. Before we kind of jump into the actual assignment, I just want to talk a little bit about this idea of looking for color in all the wrong places. Now, when we think about color, and I talked a little bit about this with, say, like a black shirt, and especially when we're talking about value, I'm wearing like a black sweater now, but you can see like highlights and shadows on my black sweater, even though we know that the color universally is black. The same is true for color. And so we have a few ideas here that will just kind of help clarify some ideas and kind of hone things in as we move along. First off is local color. And local color is the actual color of an object. So if you were to buy a green plastic bowl, it is kind of universally the same color green. Like they mix the plastic with the dye and it all is uniformly that one color green. And that is local color. So if we buy a shirt that's dyed blue, then that shirt locally is whatever that blue color is. You know, again, we can change hue and saturation and value, but it's universally all one color. And so that is local color. Perceived color is the color that you observe it to be. And there are factors that adjust the way that we see things, including light or shadow. And that'll alter the way that we see things. So again, thinking about this black shirt or that green bowl, if we have a strong single light source on it, on one side, it'll be a lot lighter. And then on the opposite side, it'll be a lot darker. Even though we know that the whole bowl is universally one color, that local color. So the way that we're perceiving is different than what we tend to think about, right? And that's important as we kind of move forward and think about what it is that we're observing versus what it is that we think it to be. I always talk about in my drawing class, you have to trust your eyes, not your brain. Because what we're really doing is we're copying the things that we're seeing, not copying the things that we think it to be, right? We're not trying to remember how it is or conjure up the way that we believe it to be. We're trying to understand it for what we're actually observing. And the last vocabulary word here is color constancy. And this is the phenomena of keeping an object's color constant under different lighting situations. So when you look at the shadows and highlights of my shirt or of that green bowl, we know that it's all the same color and that there's just something happening with the lighting that we can understand, right? But we understand it to be like all the same color still. When we look at this, I don't know what this is, like a hot air balloon, I think, whatever this giant tarp is, we could see, you know, these three stripes. We've got red, white, green, and blue. And as we go backwards, we have sort of those same stripes. We've got the white, blue, white, green, blue, and red right here. But what we're actually seeing is that these are completely different colors than this. Our brain is making sense of saying, you know, there's an order to this, and, you know, this corresponds with that, this corresponds with that, this corresponds with that, and this one with that one. And so this is color constancy, that we know that this shape and this shape of color are essentially the same. This shape and this shape of color are essentially the same. But what we want to do is really look at what it is that we're seeing. We're not just seeing red stripe or green stripe or white stripe. We're seeing a multitude of colors. If we look at this white stripe right here up in the front, we've got this like yellowy color right here. We can actually see white on the screen. This is white. This is not white. This is a yellow color. But as we move away from this kind of upwards here, it becomes sort of a bluish color. And if you don't believe me, you can actually take your color wheel and hold it right up there and just try to see, go around and see what color kind of is closest to it. That's the way that we would use that color wheel. I lost mine. No, there it is. So I could just hold it up to one section of this and see, is it more like blue, or is it more yellow, or is it more orange, or so on and so forth. Now, obviously, it's not full saturation, but it'll be within the hue family. So up here, it's sort of bluish. Up here, it gets sort of kind of neutral. This is actually maybe closest to the white of the page, right? Like right through here. And then again, as it traverses away from us, it maybe cools down a little bit. So it goes into that blue family. If we follow that white stripe into the background, what is it that we're actually seeing? If we were to look at these colors, now we understand that it's in shade, right? That this is a lighting effect. And generally, when we think of something that's in shade, we tend to think that it's going to be adding black. But in reality, black rarely exists. It doesn't really happen the way that we think it does. And in a painting, we want to avoid adding too much black to a painting. So what is it that we're actually seeing here? I'm seeing a lot of violets and reds and some blues. Right? Like that's what that color is. And it's helpful to take a piece of paper and punch a little hole in the middle, like a white piece of paper, and you can cover everything else up and just see one portion of that area. And you'll see that one color. And so you can isolate the color, compare it to white, and see what hue family it belongs to. That's a really helpful tip if you're painting. Lighter colors like white and yellow are more subject to those color variations and shifts because they're so light and they're influenced by a lot of other things. Whereas when we look at this green stripe or the blue stripe, you know, we've got some warmer greens here. We've got some more sort of fully saturated greens up here, maybe some cooler greens here. And then as we get up into the background, into the shadow, we've got a very cool green. But again, it's still within that same hue family. It's still kind of in that green range. So we're not seeing as dramatic of a shift from like yellow to blue to white to red to violet like we are seeing here. So again, still in that green family. You know, this is pretty vibrant. Out here, it gets kind of dull. So maybe it's mixing the complementary color into there. So this is sort of a blue green. So maybe there's a touch of red orange in there just to kind of calm that down a bit. But again, color constancy allows us to kind of equate this color here, this stripe, to this color here, this stripe, even though they're wildly different. In this model here, you know, we understand what we're seeing, right? We understand that there's a checker tile floor, that there's a cylinder with a lighting source, and that it's casting a shadow across the tile floor. And on the tile floor, we see light squares and dark squares, right? Everyone's in agreement here. A is a dark square, B is a light square. Because we see that there's enough information, sort of that gestalt information, that's leading us to believe that this is a light square and this is a dark square. But what we're actually seeing, if we were to really observe this, is that A, this square A, and this square B are actually the same value and same color. And if you put your finger across, if you just sort of cover up those squares in between them, and look at both A and B at the same time, you'll see that they're actually the same color. Yeah? No? Yeah, they are. So I'm covering up this square here and this square here, and I can see that this and this are the same. No, you don't believe it? some of you see it, some of you don't. You could even take if you have like Photoshop and you do like a dropper, like the eyedropper tool, you could sample that color, see what the color code is, and then you could do that for both of them and it's the same. But that's the thing, is that we're so locked in, our brains are so locked in to the order of things that it's very hard to kind of bridge that gap to say this is the same as that. And it could be a case where maybe you're blocking this between the two, but because this is next to it, it looks darker. And because this is next to this, it looks lighter. So if you could really isolate it, there'd be like, you'd have to do some crazy like hand gestures to like cover everything up and sort of squint at it, you can see that those two are the same. Not the letters themselves, but the whole tile.
I keep seeing it as being a tad lighter. B is lighter.
That could just be sort of the relative color, because these two are darker and these two are lighter around it. If you're able to fully isolate it, you would see that they are actually the same. Now this is kind of the same thing, but also different, just much more complex. So here we have this like cube with colored squares in red, and then we have the same thing in green, and we understand that this bottom square here is in the green family, or this block area here, and the top square here is in the red family. So we can see that here in the red image, and we can see that here in the green image. And you'll notice that we got this little arrow pointing to this square and this square, and these two are actually the same color. I'm looking at your reaction, and there's a lot of maybe some disbelief, but yeah, they are the same color. So it's pretty amazing what our brain can do and what it can't do. That it's really forcing us to believe that this, what we're seeing here, is a red, and that this, what we're seeing here, is a green. And that is because the surrounding colors are affecting our interpretation of it. Because this next to it is more red than this, it appears more green. So think back to last week's complementary scale. We have a red color that was turning a little bit more green and a little bit more green and a little bit more green up until the point that we hit this neutral area. And on one side of the scale, it could look red. On the other side of the scale, it could look green. And so that's exactly what's happening here. We're hitting that middle point here, where this color, because everything else around it looks more red, all of a sudden is green. Because everything around this looks more green, this reads as red. So we have to slow ourselves down. It takes tons of training to kind of understand what it is that we're perceiving and how that relates to color and how that relates to value. So it's not something that maybe you're missing right now. It's just something that is difficult to comprehend because it makes so much sense in context. And then for the last image here, now obviously this is a very red tinted image, but what we can see here is all of the different colors that would be kind of expressed within the photo. If we look at this long enough, we can see the blues of the sky and the blue, like sort of the violet blues of the distant mountains, the yellows of the field, the greens of the trees. So we're getting, you know, again, it's a very tinted image, but it's very complete in terms of all the color that we're seeing. But in reality, and this is just a more sort of digitized version of it to just help you kind of see it better. It's all really variations of red. There's blue and green lights that are firing inside your screen right now and kind of adjusting in the cones of your eye. But really what we're seeing are just variations of red. So this is a very sort of orangey red, and this is a very dull red, you know, very neutralized, cooler reds up here, lighter in value, darker in value. But really there's no blue, there's no green. It's just our brain is making sense of that. All right. So there's a lot of trickery that's happening when it comes time to deal with color. And it's important that we slow ourselves down and we really kind of try to observe and understand what it is that we're seeing. On this page, this is finding color where you least expect it. And sorry, I was just sort of thinking here. And when we talk about still lifes, you know, there's a whole host of still lifes and painting and color use and painting, obviously, that we understand to be kind of accurate the way that we would think it is. So here we have this Vermeer still life, and everything's happening the way that we would assume it to happen, right? We've got like the yellows in the lemon, we've got like reds in the crab, along with those sort of yellowy butter colors on the underside. We've got the yellows and oranges happening in the gold chalice here. We've got, I think those are olives or grapes, whatever, green. And it's happening exactly the way that we anticipate it to be. So it's very straightforward, very standard, nothing out of the ordinary, nothing challenging at all. As we move kind of forward in time, now I'm giving you a very kind of brief and abridged version of history here. There's definitely opportunities for these things to occur back in time, and it's not just a thing that was moving forward, but it was happening simultaneously, but these are just examples. In these two paintings of Manet and Monet, again, we have a very standard approach to what it is that we're seeing in terms of color. So the objects, the way that they're painted, the way that the color is being dealt with is sort of to be expected, right? We've got, you know, those, I don't know if those peaches, we got peaches here. These are maybe peaches or oranges, but you know, we've got that orangey color with some yellows and reds. Same thing happening here for these grapes. You know, we've got greens and maybe some reds, and that's sort of pretty typical. But what we can start to see is maybe hints of color in surprising areas. You know, the shadow here is very dull, but the shadow on the tablecloth here starts to pick up some of these like more luminescent colors, right? We start to see a hint of violet or blue. We start to see, you know, the tablecloth we understand is white has sort of these muddier colors going across it. So not just in the shadows, but just even in the surface of it. When we look at this Vermeer, let me scroll back up, you know, very kind of white, and the shadows feel very kind of neutral, not warm or cool. I mean, the overall effect is pretty warm because, you know, he's using daylight. But here we're getting some warm areas, some cooler areas, and that's reflected in the colors that are being chosen. In this Cezanne still life, the room we can see is probably painted this blue-green and this blue-violet, and some of that information is working its way into the tablecloth here. We're seeing that violet here. We're seeing that green here start to interject into this information. We're even seeing some blues and violets occur on the fruit themselves. Now, this could be a case of reflected light, or it could just be sort of unifying the painting. We're seeing that violet happen here on the shadows of the leaves on the pot and here as well. So we're starting to see this replacement of color where it used to be maybe an opportunity to be kind of like straightforward and maybe a bit dull. There's chances to use color here as other bits of information. And when we talk about reflected light, we can look at this, these two eggs here. We've got, you know, an egg on a yellow background, an egg on a red background, and the lighting is exactly the same, the shadows are the same, but what we can see is the light is bouncing off the surface of the yellow and reflecting on the underside of the egg. So we're getting some interjection of color on something that we know is locally white, right? Same thing is happening here. We're getting an interjection of red on an object that is locally white. And that's probably what's happening here. We're getting some of that reflected light from the surrounding bouncing onto these lighter surfaces. This is really kind of the inspiration for the assignment. I shifted a little bit. I did a different still life just because I didn't have any candy here. But Thibaut is one of my most favorite painters. He's really well known for his paintings of desserts and cakes and ice cream. But what I want to talk about is just how wild these colors are. His shadows are, you know, we can look at the shadow here. It's red and green and blue. And look how vibrant that blue is. So he's replacing maybe that dull color with something super vibrant, super hot. The shadow side of this could be glass. It could be chrome, probably glass though. Ice cream container. you know, is this teal blue, very rich in intensity. Not something that we would normally think of when it comes to a shadow. When we think shadow side, we're thinking dull. We're thinking using black or gray. In these cakes, like, look at all these shadows. We've got these blues happening, turning into violets as they get further away. For the whipped cream topping, you know, we've got some white here. We've got some blues here. Pinks here, just a really big range of how he's using those colors to create the volume and shape of these objects. And when we look at them individually, they look really kind of out of place. We think like, oh, that is a pretty crazy like teal color with this sort of orangey brown mixed into it. But when we take a step back, when we look at the entire image as a whole, it makes complete sense. It reads the way that we would normally think it would read. So the opportunity to find color in places that we think color isn't there is really what Thibaut is exploring here. Again, just, you know, these great blues in place for these shadows here. Look at the blue on this little bread. So the shadow side of that little sandwich. It's great. The next artist is Conrad Ruiz, and he's one of my closest friends. He actually has a show up currently. He has two shows up currently in LA. And he is a fantastic watercolor painter. I highly suggest that you check out his website. You could just type his name in, Conrad Ruiz, and just see the work that he does aside from the things that I'm showing you here. He has such a mastery of color, and he's able to get so much intensity. He's painting in watercolor in all of these images, I think, and these are relatively large scale. I think this one is 4x5, I believe, and if you were to look at this up close, it's actually just made up of like blobs of color, but it reads like, you know, this guy kind of on fire crashing into a pool of water. And you can just see how much detail is sort of perceived to be there, but it's actually just kind of blobby shapes. Here we got this guy on fire. Again, just kind of these blobby shapes. And he's just building up that color, building up that intensity. But he has such a great understanding of how color works. That these are fantastic. This painting here, I think, is it's crazy. It's I think it's 7 feet by 15 feet. Humongous. It's this giant watercolor painting. And you can just see all these like colors that are happening all throughout the entire painting. You know, just all the richness of like these greens and blues and violets, and then these deep violets up through here, blues and violets in the shadow side of the suit. It was great. And this is in the UC Berkeley collection. So if you ever go up there, I don't know if they have it on display, but it's in their collection. Leah Gardner is an artist that I found online. I don't know too much about her. I think she's a relatively new painter, and I think she's mainly self-taught. These are in acrylic, but I do want to point it out just to show like how vibrant her colors are. You know, she does very mundane things like candy or wine glasses or glasses of water. But we can see just like the read on these slices of cantaloupe. You know, we've got the lights and shadows peeking through the leaves here. The shadow side is all done in these blue colors. We have reflected light coming off the cantaloupe. Sort of clear see-through areas reflecting and refracting. It's really, really great, really interesting, but a lot of color. And I think that's exciting. And this really simple painting of a water, a glass of water. You know, we've got all of these colors. We've got these, this peach, green, violets, blues. All very interesting. Got lollipops. I love this. I love this like transition from reds to violets to blues for the shadow. Like the, it really helps sell the idea that these, that the candy is translucent, that it's letting the light kind of shine through. Erica Lee Sears is also another artist that I just found online. Also very young, I think self-taught as well. She's been painting for about 7 years. And this is great, just, you know, cut up fruit. We've got that green side for the white rind right there. We got this purple here for the other side of the rind on the grapefruit. Just a huge range of color. This one's really exciting. You know, we've got like purples and reds, greens to peach. We got peach and green on sort of opposite sides. We've got greens in the shadows, peach and blue on the tabletop surface. It's a very, what we would think is a very sort of basic image to paint is rendered infinitely complex because of how much color and how much saturation she's finding in every opportunity. And that's really what I want to stress. That's sort of the thing that I want to push, is this idea that we can push color and still have it read the way that we want it to. We can find complexity in color to make these objects really become that much more dynamic. So for this assignment, I suggest using candy or any brightly colored objects. The more colorful, the better, and you want a variety of colors. And for the examples that I have here, I'm using maybe a color scheme to kind of create some relationships between them. So here I have a split complement. I've got greens, and then maybe this is like a cool green, and this would be like the yellow and red. So sort of split complement. You know, you can fuss around a little bit with that. This is the same objects, but with a red fill light. So I'm using a lighting source that's creating more color. So I'm just putting like cellophane in front of my light just to create even more color. Here's a blue light. And this is maybe analogous objects, so reds to yellows. This is a tetrad. Remember, a tetrad is two sets of complementary colors. So I've got blues and oranges, greens and reds. And this has a red fill light. So the shadows here, all of a sudden, rather than just being sort of dull gray shadows, you can see the shadows are in that red family. The shadows here are violet, again, in that red family. Here's that same tetrad, just maybe rearranged with a violet light. And this is coming from the other side. And then just another option. So you have a lot of options that you can work from if you don't want to create your own still life. You can use any of these images here. And really what we're looking for are opportunities to create color into the painting. And we want to avoid using black, right? So in the case of all of these paintings, I'm not going to use any black for these paintings. In this area here that's really dark, or this area here around the ring, rather than using black, I would use something really, really dark, maybe a dark violet or dark blue. And maybe if it's too saturated, I can dull it out by adding some of the complements. So just adding a little bit of yellow or orange is going to make it less saturated, but it'll still be in that blue family. Right. For painting the still... Sorry. I gotta remember to turn that off. For painting the still life, it's going to be pretty straightforward. We're just going to transfer the image and just kind of go to town, working on saturation, working on trying to get as much color into the painting as possible. I'll have to dig it out here. We'll take a little break coming up in a second. But I have a few of these already painted, so we can take a look at. That's the discussion. And then for this week, I already set up my still life and lit it. This is a much more straightforward still life. And I just want to show you maybe my approach. Rather than having all of those colors already sort of plugged in with the lighting is red or violet, I have a much more natural light source, right? This looks like regular light. But I'm going to show you how I'm going to approach adding color into areas that maybe don't necessarily read like they have color. So like the shadows area, shadows here, and I've got a lot of browns here that you're like, well, it's just brown. Where are you going to grab that color from? So we'll talk more about that. And this is the image that I'm using today and that we'll be working from, or I'll be working from, for our painting for today and next week. Are there any immediate pressing questions right now? No? Okay. We'll take a 10-minute break. I'm going to sort of reset, kind of like set my my side up over here, and then we'll jump into the painting. So we'll do 10 minutes. Okay? Okay. I think that was 10. Okay, so we'll kind of transition over to the painting right now. But before we do that, I just want to show you some of the work from those previous examples in the assignment. So let me switch over to that. Okay. Yeah. So here is one of the here is one of the previous paintings. This was that tetradic one with the violet light. Can we see that? Sorry. You can see let's use this to point with. You can maybe make that out. I'm using a blue violet for the shadow area right here, this deep blue green for that shadow area up there. These shadows out here are definitely in that violet family. So nowhere in this do I have any black. This color here for the ring and like this color here is like a deep violet with a little bit of red in it. You can kind of see like a hint of that color kind of peeking through there. I'm gonna bring it up close so maybe you can see that a little bit better. Keep it in focus. There you go. All right. So there's a lot of color opportunities in the painting. And then in this one, this had that red light on it. And this was the split complement. And so again, like things that you would normally think of as black or gray are just really deep, intense colors. Like these are really dark reds, kind of muddy a little bit here too, just on the kind of muddier side, but still in the red or violet family. Here I've got some dark, dark reds that are happening. For the shadows, I'm using sort of these blues, and obviously because of that red light, I was getting my shadows to look really reddish. So that's what I, you know, they're obviously red there. So there's that. And there's a kind of close version of it. And really, when we're dealing with painting, it's really just about blobs of color and just building up and getting those blobs of color, those shapes, to be where they're supposed to be. All right. So for mine,
Which picture are we supposed to do? The one with the fan, you said?
Well, I'm doing the one with the fan. You could do anything. If you want to set up your own still life, you can set up your own still life. Yeah.
Thank you. I printed this one up from yours. I thought that's what you had on your video thing.
Yeah. I mean, you can work with that one. That's fine. Yeah.
I like that fan. Do you have it in there?
Yeah, it's going to be on the last page where I have the Zoom, like the recorded Zoom session. I just posted this photo, so you can.
Did you? Okay, I'm gonna go over there and look. Thank you. Maybe yeah. I'll print that and do it.
Does that work? I feel like something might have shifted here. I think we're okay. All right, that's fine. Let me just pull up my other thing here. I just want to see if I can adjust this better. Is that too far away? Do you want it closer? Do you like, do you prefer the closer one, like this one? Is that okay? Okay. All right, so we'll stick with this.
Yeah.
All right, so I have, I will, let me throw this in the chat really quick. And then also, this is to everyone. So I'm just going to put the image I'm working from in the chat. So if you need it, then it's here, as well as being on the recorded Zoom session page. Pamela, your screen keeps flickering, so I'm just going to shut your screen off. Okay. But you'll be able to watch what I'm doing. Okay. I can't hear you because you're muted.
Oh. Is flickering there? Do you want me to stop the video?
Yeah.
There?
Yeah, please. Yeah.
But listen, I'm trying to find that so I can print it out. What is it listed under?
It'll be on the module page of recorded Zoom session. It's the last page of week 4's module.
Okay, so I see home, I see modules, I see announcements, Zoom, grades, people, and syllabus, new analytics.
Go to modules, and then week 4.
Wait a minute, let me see, week 4. Okay, let me go down there.
And then it's going to be the last page, the recorded Zoom session week 4.
Oh, in there, okay. Yes,
correct.
Thank you, yeah.
All right, so we got a, we're all here on the same page. And I've got my image already transferred over, so you can all see that. I just got like a billion windows open here. Now, what I'm looking for are opportunities to introduce as much color into this painting as possible. So, you know, obviously, the yellow fan, the green bottle, the red band, and the blue band are going to be those colors that we already know. The gold octopus here, you know, there's yellow in there, there's lighter colors, but then there's also some darker colors. And those darker colors are probably, you know, we want to stay in that dark family, but because I feel like there's a lot of yellow that's happening, I might go the opposite. So for the shadow areas, I'm going to do like a neutralized violet. Okay. When it comes to objects that are brown, so let's say like the wooden frog here or this little toy thing, brown is just a neutral color. But it tends to have a bias towards one of the 12 colors on the color wheel. So if we were looking at this guy here, this thing is in the yellow orange family, right? If we're looking at this thing here, this is in the orange, maybe red orange family. But what we're seeing is that they're neutralized versions of that color. So that just means we're going to mix that out with some neutral colors. For the shadows and the walls, this is where maybe I have more opportunity to introduce some color, right? Rather than going for like gray or black. I feel like this shadow over here is pretty warm, and then this shadow here is warm, whereas these shadows might be a little on the cooler side. Over here, because this is semi-transparent or translucent, I'm getting some green that's happening in this shadow over here. So I'm gonna pick up some of that green. Because this is in that orange family, I'm getting a little bit warmer shadows through here. Because again, we're sort of thinking like it's influencing what's around it. But they're very muted. They're very dull versions of those colors. But if I can pump up the color somewhat, I'm going to pump up that color somewhat. We are going to work on this for 2 weeks. This is a pretty complex painting. There's a lot of different things happening. So we'll see how far I can get today. And then more than likely, we'll be doing it for next week as well. I'm going to be using my tube paint, and I'm just going to walk you through what I have here. I've got some white, black. This is a burnt umber, and this is a yellow ochre color. So those are browns, burnt umber and yellow ochre. Yellow, red, orange. That looks like a crimson red. That looks like a magenta. This is violet. That's a dark blue, like an ultramarine. This is almost like a cobalt blue here. That is a phthalo green. I think this is, or maybe that's a phthalo blue and that's a phthalo green. I'm gonna have to wet that out. This is yellow. This is just a different blue. It's kind of a duller gray blue already. I have a little leftover yellow orange, yellow green in there. And this is black, and this is, looks blue. I don't know what it is. And then over here, I have like a, probably the same color I just laid out. And then I have another palette up here, and this just has that black. But again, I want to avoid using black for this painting. So basically, I won't be tapping into my black here, here, or here. It's just in my palette, but I'm not going to be using it. And then another thing is when I put this palette down, it had some blue paint on it on the bottom, and it got onto my paper. So I already got some blue on there, and then I just wet it out and like shoved it off. Just sort of like try to make it disappear as much as possible. But that's what you're seeing. This is a little bit of blue up through here. That was unintentional. It was a little bit of a mistake, but whatever. We're fine. All right. Looking at my painting, I feel like the easiest thing for me to understand right now is the green bottle and this yellow handle. There is a little bit of lightness that's happening on this side of the yellow, but pretty much it's uniformly the same yellow. So I'm just going to get a little bit lighter through here, but I can cover basically the entire thing with yellow, and I'm okay with that. And we'll sort of see why. But I'm going to start with this green bottle first and just kind of work my way left to right. So I have to mix out some green. So I need to loosen up this yellow here. And it's kind of like falling apart on me. And all I'm doing is it's dried up paint, but I can just sort of agitate it a bit and try to keep it in there and loosen that up. Now it has green on it. That's just because it was dirty from me mixing on it, but it is yellow under there. This thing is. Taking its time. There we go. Probably when it comes time to paint the fan, I'm going to squeeze out a new yellow just so I have a clean yellow to work from, rather than this or this, which is already sort of tainted as well. All right, so that's It's pretty bright green. I just want to get a little bit more green on there. So I'm going to loosen this up. Need some water too. And that. There's that yellow. And here's some of that green. A chunk of yellow there. I'll just sort of push it off to the side. Now, to get some variation in this color, you know, there's dark parts and lighter parts. The way that I'm going to do that is through thinning this out with water, but also by adding maybe the complement to dull it out. So there's like areas here in the handle and the spring within the sprayer that need to go a little bit duller and darker. So I think I'm pretty good here. So this is a nice overall base color here that I can start off with. And I'm going to start kind of thin. So I'm using more water, just adding water to this pile here. And I like to put my water off to the side. Like this is my main paint, my water is somewhere else. They're touching, that's fine. But I just know that I have more water over on this side, which means that when I test it, it should be thinner. And you can kind of see that peek up through on the edge of the screen. So now, hand is clean. This is pretty much all the same green. So I'm starting off pretty light anyway. So I can just come in here and just start painting maybe the entire thing. I have a lot of like fluid on the page, so I just want to make sure I'm spreading that around, I'm trying to let it lay down evenly so it's not pulling up and getting too dense. I have this small little cutaway right in there. You can see that in my transfer, I did a pretty simplified version of a transfer. So I don't have a lot of detail in there. I have the major shapes, but not all of the small details. You know, you can sort of dictate how much information you have on there, and that'll be up to you. This is enough information for me to kind of make sense of what it is that I'm seeing. And I'm actually going to take the same green. Like I said, I'm seeing some green over there, and I'm going to pick up maybe some of this deeper green, this like phthalo green. I'm mixing it off my, can you guys see that? Sorry. Yeah, okay. I'm just mixing it off my palette over here, just in this area. So a little bit of that, cool that down a bit. Like so, and then I'm going to pick up some of that. Just that was a little bit of that, probably alizarin crimson, I think. You can see that got kind of muddy. And I'm going to use that for my shadow shape over on this side. Things are still a little bit wet, but I can block in. Maybe I need a little bit more crimson in there. And that's just to help dull that out some. Just gonna have to clean up that little splotchiness right there. Okay. Now I'm gonna clean my brush off, just wiping it off and then swishing it in the water. this is starting to set up pretty quickly. I think I left the heater on, so it's kind of dry in here. So this is my more pure pile. It's not as watery. And I'm going to come in here. I'm going to start to build up some of this color here. So I'm going to lay that down like so. It's sort of all the way through here. Down through here. Now I like to do this little trick here where I've laid down this paint, and then I just take a semi-wet brush and I'm just going to break that edge a little bit. And that's just going to let that paint bleed out and not be such a hard edge where I had it. And so now I'm still looking at my photo, and I'm just going to start building up these darker greens as they kind of move across the surface. Now, I'm not thinking about detail at all. I'm just trying to draw or paint what I'm seeing kind of in real time. And I feel like I've done this enough that I can kind of get in here and be pretty accurate without all of the detail. It's a bit heavy. That's pretty good. I'll let that set for a second. And then I'll do another pass. Now, I don't want to go too far with just one object. I want to make sure that I'm moving across the page and working on the entire painting. But I figure this is a fairly simple thing. I've got kind of the color that I want, and I could build up methodically to it. So that's what I'm doing here. That's pretty dry. So now I'm just going to get some of these other bits of information that I'm seeing. I picked up a little bit of red there for some reason. That's okay. It's on the shadow side anyway. Yeah, there's some red right there. See it. But, you know, I kind of like that. I'm going to stick with that. So I'm not getting enough, like the paint's not dry enough just yet. So I'm losing kind of my ability to control the paint. So I'm just gonna stop it where I'm at. And then move on to something else. Now, I wouldn't recommend that you paint this. I'm painting pretty tight already. You don't have to. I really suggest that you block the painting out. Really basic. Okay. I'm getting like a small halo that I just want to pick up. So I just clean my brush off. I'm just picking up some of that green, getting a little bit deeper greens through like this edge, right through here. Be good. All right, so I'm gonna stop and leave that. And then for the fan, I'm gonna squeeze out some yellow paint because that's a bit dry. I don't want to have to work too hard for it. So I just got some lemon yellow. And I don't need much. This looks pretty clean over here. I mean, that's pretty good to start off with, just a small bit. I want to make sure that, see, my water here is sort of green tinted. I don't want to use that water anymore when I mix out this yellow because it'll make it green. So I've got clear water in my other cup. I'm just going to make sure my brush is relatively clean. And I can loosen this up using my clean water here. I have paint out this way. I want to be careful of that I don't introduce that into my color. All right. So like I said, you know, yellow is such a bright color and light color that it's easy to paint right over the top. So I'm not too worried about like the reds and greens and blues here. I could paint this thing, and I'm not even worried about the shadow shapes. I could do the whole thing in yellow right now. And that'll just give me, yeah, a good base to start off with. Just using my brush, do my best to fill this in fairly evenly. A little bit more water. Now it is a little lighter over on this side, so maybe as I get to that side, I'm gonna add some water to the paint so it's not as intense. I mean, obviously I can build up deeper and richer color as I need to. So now this is where it's pretty light out there. I think I can add more color to that. Same thing into this handle. This handle's pretty intense. So I'm gonna pick up some of that actual color. Just bring that in. And so. That's fine. I think that's color. Oops, drag through. I feel like it's maybe more intense up here, so I can just kind of push that color up through here. Maybe right through here. Just maybe thin it out just a bit down this way. So this is that local color that we're talking about. Right. I'm sort of disregarding any of the shadow or light areas, and I'm really just thinking about that local color, and that works well here. It wouldn't work well if we're talking about, say, blue or whatever. We want to be a bit more exacting about that. But for yellow, I think it works well. All right, so that's a pretty good spot to sit. So I just cleaned off my brush. And so now in my water cups, I've got that green water there, sort of greenish yellow. And this one, I mean, it's still pretty clear, but this is kind of in that yellow family. So warmer versus cooler paints. And rather than have to go change my water every time I switch to a new color, I'm just going to stick with this one being my cool colors and this one being my warm colors. All right. Checking my hands. So I'm looking at the just the overall composition, and I think I like the coolness of this wall, sort of that mistake, which is just kind of happenstance, and I think that. Because all these objects, like this one, actually all of them, are in that really warm family. Even this green is a warm green. I'm going to use a cool color, like a very muted blue, for the walls and the ground. So this is almost set up there. It's still a little bit wet. But I'm going to go ahead and start mixing out maybe this... this blue here, and that way I can do something with the ground. So I'm just loosening this paint up just enough to where I can get some on my brush and mix the color that I want. Now I want this to be very, very thin, very loose. So this, it's intense right now because it's sitting in the well, but I'm just going to take that paint out here like that, and I'm going to add a lot of water to this, just a ton of water, because I want this not to be too blue. I just want it to have just a little hint of blue in there, just some coolness. So I'm just adding more and more and more water. And to dull this out, to make it less saturated, I'm going to add some orange. And I have this, we've got this orange here. I'm just going to grab a little bit of that, mix that in. And you can see it stayed pretty cool. Sorry, let me bring that over. It stays pretty cool, but it's not as intense as it was. Just more water. Okay, I'm gonna use my big brush on this one. I'm just gonna get that wet. That's adding even more water to it. And I'm gonna do a little test, and that's, you didn't see it right there. That's the color I want. I have to be careful. It's still just a touch wet right there. I don't want those two to bleed together. Just sort of around that. That's fine. There we go. That's pretty good. There's a little bit of an ombre effect happening here from like darker to lighter right here in the corner. I'm not overly worried about that. If I want to do it, I can put that in there. I'm just going to lay some paint down like so. Just up and around this. It's going to be pretty blocky. You can see I'm running out of paint, and that's fine. If I had a lot of paint, though, I could stop here and then clean my brush off on like a paper towel, get a little bit of water, and then just bring the paint that's on the surface out over. And that'll just lighten it up, just break up that edge a bit.
Mark, is this one right here going to be in a video?
This is a bit, yes, I'm recording this currently.
Because I'm going to go see that King Tut thing in Del Mar shortly here, and so I'm going to have to leave early.
That's fine.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right. So down below, it feels a little brighter, so I'm going to just wet this out even more. I just picked up the same blue. Instead of the orange, though, I'm going to maybe pick up some of this yellow. It's going to turn it greenish, and that's okay. But I'm going to make it really, really light. And I'm only using this sort of down here, fading it up to kind of this area here. This area I'm going to keep pretty white here. But out here towards the extremities, working my way towards that corner, I just want to add some color. And I think that this is maybe the right choice. Yeah. So it's, I don't even know if you could see that on screen. It's barely visible for me. There's a little bit of green on the surface there. And this is just helping kind of get rid of the white of the page to let the white, the really bright areas, start to become more luminescent. All right, so it's a little bit lighter there. Down through here. And again, I'm just going to clean my brush off, pick up some water, and then just sort of soften that edge out. Soften that edge out right there. Now I might push that a bit further. Let me get some shadow there. I might push that a bit further later on down the line, but right now it's enough for me to see. It's enough for me to kind of like understand some colors and some choices, and that's really all I want. All right. So that for that big brush. I feel like I want to do this frog today. So we'll work on that. So for the frog, I said it's in the yellow orange family, so I'm just gonna go with orange here. This looks like it's maybe red orange. This one. Just agitating. So now this is where I'll be mixing today. There. So I'm just loosening up enough of this orange to kind of introduce here. I've got some yellow on there. And I want to adjust this color to be close to the yellow orange that I need it to be. So it's probably going to take all that yellow in there. You can see I've got like chunks in my brush. So I want to make sure that I really get in there and mix all those off so I don't end up with like streaks in my paint. All right. Pretty good. Now, I have two options here. My first option is to dull this out using blue. So let me just show you what that does. So I have, I'll just make a small pile here. Here's my orange. If I were to use some of this blue that I have, maybe I'll just go with this one here. Or I think it has to be this blue. So this is a ultramarine blue. If I use this blue, I might need some violet here. I can start to make that darker. You can see how dark that started to get. And the more orange I have in there, like so, I need a little bit of this violet. It sort of turned greenish, so that means I'm missing some of the red. So you can see now adding some violet, which has red in it, it turned it into a brown. Right now, that's a pretty good brown. I can pick up some orange here and push that brown to be more orangey. There, you can kind of see that. Rather than that, if you have brown in your kit, you could use brown. Brown is essentially a neutralizer. So it's a neutral color. So brown can be between orange and blue, red and green, yellow and violet. This yellow ochre is obviously yellow with some violet in it. This burnt umber is kind of in the orange family. And so since I'm in the orange family already, I'm going to use some of this burnt umber. So I'm going to loosen this up. Sienna is a reddish color, so that's going to be like a reddish brown. So there's my brown, there's my orange. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to start in on this frog using my orange here. And for me, what I'm seeing is the lightest part of this frog is this like bright orange color. So I could just kind of come in here and kind of paint pretty loose using this orange color. Kind of everywhere-ish. I could make some adjustments to how thin or intense my color is. But I'm pretty happy with it so far. So I'm just picking up that orange color. The stick is sort of the same deal here. So I'll just come in here with that same color. You can see I'm being really liberal and loose with how I'm painting this. Now, over here, I've got this kind of confusing area that's lighter, but it's not really orangey. It's sort of like it's a lighter brown. So I'm just gonna leave that there. Like so. Okay, there you go. Get a little bit more there. All right, so now picking up some of this brown, I'm gonna mix some orange into it here, like that. Now I can come in and start to find some of these browner areas. But you'll see by adding a little bit of orange to it, it kind of keeps it in the same family. So I'm just going to work my way through, thinking about creating that structure. It's a little wet. I should wait. But I'm sort of in a I'm not feeling this moment. All right, we'll wait. Got away from me there. All right, so we're gonna wait on that for a second. We'll let that orange kind of set up. I don't want it to bleed out of control. And then we'll kind of jump back in. That's pretty good. So now I'm gonna kind of dive back in here. I have a lot of paint on there. So I'm just pulling some of that brown, some of that orange, mixing them together, and then just kind of working my way through the object, thinking about the shapes and values that I'm seeing. Not so much trying to like outline or draw the object. Instead, I'm painting shapes of color. This like ridge is dark on the left side, but on the top side it's brown. So I'm gonna paint that in. And then over here, it gets a little lighter. And here, it's sort of in that brown family. Got that dark mouth opening here. That I'll kind of deal with a little bit later. In brown area. Brown. Got a lot of like dark shadows that are happening down below here. But then I have a lot of like solid brown down this way. I'm just working my way through. I'm building this little frog out. I think it's looking pretty good. Oh yeah, the stick. This side, brownish. Up here, just a little bit, right there. And I can make these really minute adjustments because I have this pile of brown, this pile of orange, and just kind of get right in between those two colors just by mixing them together. Now I've got some dark areas down here. I'm not worried about, say, the texture of the wood. I'm still just thinking about the overall shape and dimension that I'm seeing. All right, so now I'm going to thin this out. So I have a, you can see it's really thinned out. I want it to be very transparent because I'm getting this like sort of brownish area right here that's very light. Same right there, same right there, and just right there. There's just a few spots where maybe it's not as dark or as heavy. That should be brown. So I'm just gonna pick up some brown, mix in a little bit of orange to that, get this back. I need more paint. It's pretty dark down through here. So that's a pretty good start. Pretty good start to this. I have to let it set for a second. Any questions or concerns right now about this?
Are you working primarily from the photograph or the still life?
From the photograph, but I do have the still life right here beside me. Mm-hmm. So I can like always refer back to it. It's kind of the same thing when you're doing it. If you can train yourself to flatten out the three-dimensional still life, it's the same as working from a photograph. You just have to make sure that you maintain the same viewing position. So I'm looking at the frog right now, both in person and here on my painting, and I feel like I could go a little redder. I think I went a little bit too much yellow. And I think that's fine. It's an easy shift to make that I'll make as I continue forward. That's still wet. All right, so we're just waiting. What I would like to do today is get to a pretty good spot with the frog and also start in on some of the detail of this fan, some of the deeper information of the fan. So that means like the light and dark areas. So that's kind of my main focus for today. Generally though, when you paint, you should be working throughout the entire image. Don't just focus on one object and then like push it to completion. You wanna work on this, 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 work on all of this simultaneously. Because what that does is it brings the entire painting up at the same time and nothing gets left behind. Nothing looks different. So if I were to do just the frog and leave everything else, as I make changes up here, it's going to really affect the way that the frog looks, or it's going to affect the way that the bottle looks. And sometimes mentally, if you're like, I'm finished with this frog, and then all of a sudden I paint the fan and it looks a little weird or different, I'd be more resistant to make some changes because I feel like this is complete. So if your attitude is to just kind of work on this a little bit and this a little bit and everything a little bit at a time, then everything's raising up and pushing forward at the same rate. Versus one thing finished, everything else left. It's a common issue that occurs. It happens to me, but I feel pretty confident to not kind of fall into that. We'll see.
Mark?
Yes.
Could you possible put the picture that we can see the picture when you are painting? I can see the picture.
So it's
you used to put it at the top.
It's in my talking head here, like if you could see my face, but also it's in Canvas. So if you want to take a look at the image, you can go to Canvas.
No, I was just thinking that I would like to see the picture when you are painting and explaining, so we can. No, but that's okay. It's too much trouble.
Wait, which picture?
The one that you are painting right now.
Okay, so I did put it in the chat. Yes, it is in the chat, but it's also on Canvas if you want.
Yeah, but
it's here in the chat. I'll send it again if you need. There you go. And then can you see my picture, like me? I could also just do this. I can cover up me, and then you get to take a look at that simultaneously. Okay. All right, so let's make some adjustments here. I do want to go, I want to jump into this dark area here, because I feel like it's throwing me off not having it. And for something that dark, I'm going to stick with like a violet. And because I need to go more orange here, I'm going to push that violet to be kind of this like with this red and the violet together. I think that'll give me what I want. So get some violet. And this one, I'm going to go pretty dark, because it's really dark here. So I'm mixing up that violet. Not a lot of water is what I basically mean. And then I want some of this magenta right there. I can mix those two together, kind of right there. Now, I don't want it to just be sort of this crazy intense color. I want it to be a bit more neutral when it does sort of peek through. So there's that. So I'm going to add some of this brown to it. Maybe more violet to go darker. Brown. If I feel like it's not even going dark enough still, I could add blue to it, because it's, you know, blue is in that violet family. So, but I think that's okay. Maybe just a bit more magenta in there. I'm just going to test that out. Yeah, that's fine. So I need just a touch of water on here, just to kind of keep it fluid. Go. And I'm moving around all over the thing. That's pretty dark. That's what I wanted. I'm going to get that pupil. I'm just going to make it all dark. It's fine. Kind of a silly looking frog. I have other really dark areas, but what I want to do is I want to adjust this slightly so that way it starts to sit closer to the correct family. So I'm going to pick up more of this red or magenta and more brown and get it just a touch away from that dark violet. Brown. That's better. It's a little warmer. So now I can come in here and that's a bit still too red. I want more neutral than that. Just picking up that brown color, mix that together. There you go, it's a little more brown. So it's pretty thick. It's not overly watery. And I'm going to simplify this out just a touch. I need to hit water. Put water on that. These are not too, they're not as dark as that, though. I just want to take a little bit of that paint off. Just lighten that up a bit. That's heavy. Brush is so saturated. Not enough paint. It's a bit of a push-pull kind of thing. I'm not afraid of like having the colors read a little bit wild. Because I think the overall effect, and also I think one thing I failed to sort of mention is that even if those colors are off, if the value is correct, then it's going to look like what it's supposed to look like. So you could make the most wild sort of like clownish colorful painting. If your values are the correct values, it's still going to look like what it's supposed to look like. So I'm not afraid of this being as purple or as violet as it is right now. It's fine. I'm being very delicate with this. Looking for all my dark shapes right now. Get this a bit thinner. So I want to just pick that up right there. That's good. Oh, wrong thing. Okay. So now I've got this purple, I've got this orange, I've got this brown. I think I have enough to kind of like bust around with some stuff. Go dark here. And I'm going to just build up more of these darker values. Away around. that's better. Yeah, so now when I cover up that those colors are starting to look closer to what I wanted it to be. So I'm picking up a little bit, it's sort of glazing those colors together, but also mixing sort of those reddish oranges right back up onto it. There we go. I'm going to go darker. I should wait. Yeah, I'll wait. So now that's pushing into like the color family that I wanted, I was sitting a little bit too yellow. So I made some adjustments, you know, and now it's starting to take more shape. And so brown objects tend to be really tricky because it's hard to understand where it's at and where it's going. And it's hard to relate brown to one of those colors on the color wheel. It's weird thinking that there's like a bluish brown or a reddish brown. Like reddish brown is actually pretty easy. Orangey brown is pretty easy. But when you start to get into like a poplar, that's a very greenish brown color. So training yourself to kind of see neutrals, but also finding those opportunities to pick up that color is hard to do sometimes. I think I can do this. Just a little more orange in there. I'm just looking at it on screen, and I feel like I can simplify that out a bit. Yeah, that's better. It's getting a little fussy in there, and I'd rather kind of build up some of the shape and volume rather than have all the like weird shapes and detail. I think we're gonna do the same right here, just kind of block this in a bit more. Still, that's still very wet, so I want to be careful with that super dark part. Otherwise, it'll bleed out and kind of start to pollute everything else. I'm missing some of the dark area here, so I'm going to pick that up like I just did with this. Maybe a little bit more dark area right in here to define that front leg. And right around the eye, there's like a socket where the eye sits in. And also maybe the back feels pretty good. I think it's just the leg behind this leg and around the eye. And I think the frog will be pretty pretty complete. Now, you know, this should get the same kind of color treatment. I'm just not working on this right now because I don't want, you know, sort of cross-contamination. Even though they're the same color, even though they're the same wood, I don't want the shapes that I'm painting here to bleed into there or for us to have to wait for it to dry. So that's kind of my decision right now. But we're pretty dry. All right, so I'm picking up some of this violet over here, this really dark brownish red violet. Oh man, I just brought some water into it. I got the pure one over there. I'll just test that. Okay. And I'm gonna just get in here and really start to get some of these darker shapes that are happening. I need a bit more paint on there. Because especially down here, it gets very tight and kind of fussy. Just like that. Just like that. Just like this one right there. So that right there. Behind this leg is a little bit, it kind of fades out that way. It's a lot of paint or water on my brush. So I'm just gonna pick some of that up. Right there on the knee, we can get. All right, this backside right there needs just a touch, like so. Anywhere else? Just clean that up a bit. All right. All right, so now there's just this socket here that's pretty dark. And I will make the white of that eye kind of yellowy once everything else dries up around it. I'm going to pick up some of this yellow, orange, and some of that brown. So just come in here and just backfill right up to that edge. So I don't get that white halo. Or as big of a white halo. I should really wait. Okay. All right. that turned out pretty good. I do think maybe just a touch more color and value down here. So I'm just going to thin that out a little bit. Just like that. Just get rid of some water. Just drag it. So,
Mark.
Yes.
It's Bella. I'm back. I have a question about your still life setup.
Mm-hmm.
How do you do that? Is it a special like portfolio you use, or how do you create that space for your silhouette?
Oh,
your still life. The back, you know, the backdrop.
Yeah. Here, I can break it apart and I can show you. Because we're letting things dry. So let me switch screens here. This one. So you should be able to see me. Not yet. Wait for it.
I have the exact same squirt bottle, same color, everything.
All right, so there, I'm back. Okay. So here's my still life right here, and let me drag it over so I'm not twisting everything. I was gonna do candy because that was sort of the assignment. So I have a Kit Kat here, but it's a little weird and a little flat. So this thing is.
That was candy.
Which one? This is really just, it's a foam core. And I just hot glued it to a box that I cut three sides off of. So it's just a box. And I just glued the foam core in there. So then I have like a nice white background. And then if I want, I could like, so I have that. I can drape a sheet over it if I was so inclined. I have a towel over here.
Because I find all the other stuff in the background is very distracting. So this is really nice, what you created.
So you could drape a sheet. Yeah, yeah. You can put like, you know, I've got like boxes here. So if you want, you can drape the sheet over it. And then you can create different levels of objects. And then if I have like a light source, I can create different light sources. So this is just a really easy kind of, you know, I order so many things on Amazon. I have boxes and boxes of stuff. If you don't have foam core, just putting white paper up on the inside of the box works too. You know, and it's not as distracting.
Thank you.
Sure. Okay, so where were we? There's that. And
they said you cannot start your video because the host has stopped it. I cannot see myself. I don't know. Did I do something wrong?
No. Yeah, I turned it off because your video was flickering. And it's distracting. So I just turned off the video for you.
Oh, okay. Okay. Well, I was wondering if I did something wrong.
Yeah. No, you're fine. It's just, I don't know why there's a couple of you and your screens are flickering every now and then. And so for me, I'm like a little bit distracted and just want to.
Yeah, I noticed that. Yes. Uh-huh.
I think that it might be because you need to update Vimeo.
Oh, okay.
Because I was having a problem and then I updated things and it quit.
Okay. Yeah, so you might go about updating your internet browser, your Zoom, like all of the things if you're able to. That might help.
Okay.
Okay, so we're back to the painting here. I've got like a billion things on my screen.
So you kind of have some foreshortening going on here too, on the perspective things.
I mean, not really foreshortening. Foreshortening is what we would describe when something's like, something that is normally long is stacked and visually kind of compressed. That's what foreshortening is. So, in the instance of like, say this is foreshortening. So if we have a brush here and you were looking at it, that looks like a brush. So it's always looking like a brush. But if it looks like this, man, it's shaky. if we're looking at it like that, that's foreshortening, right?
Gotcha.
Okay, so. Pretty good. I'm kind of happy with that frog. I'm going to work on this a little bit just because I got the paint and it's the same color. So I want to continue that. And then I'm going to work on that fan here. So let me just kind of jump in here and sort of push this a little bit. There. And I'm just going to get that shadow side on this over here. It's a little wet still. I sort of lost the shape. It got a little blobby. So I'm going to kind of refine it a bit. Three stripes. That. And shadow side there, shadow side there. A little bit more paint. Shadow side there-ish. A little bit of shadow up in there. Shadow there. So you're running out of real estate. I'm gonna get this really dark color here. Thought it was. It kind of disappeared on me. I used it up. Just get this. A little bit darker there. Just a bit more brown. All right, that's pretty good. When I come in with these shadows, when I do the shadows on the frog, I can clean up that edge some and get that even more refined because it got a little sloppy on that bottom. Yeah, that's good. Okay. Okay. Slide this over. So this fan is pretty complex. You can see it in my talking head here if I disappear. There is a lot going on, and I didn't really think about it when I put it on there, but I'm not one to kind of shrink away from something that's difficult to paint. But that being said, I do think that I would simplify it. And it's not so much that I have to paint every single detail exactly where it is. It's enough to kind of give the suggestion. So if you're painting, say, a brick wall or anything with a lot of like detail and pattern, especially if it repeats itself, you don't have to give the viewer everything. I mean, if you're making something that is supposed to look photorealistic, then by all means, go all in. But if you're painting something that's a little bit more painterly, a little bit looser, sometimes the suggestion is enough to kind of get us there. It's enough to kind of make sense of what it is that we're seeing. So on that note, you know, it's enough to just kind of indicate that there's like a light side, a dark side, a light side, a dark side. And if you do that just enough, not all over, we'll sort of make sense of it and we'll see it for what it's supposed to be. I'm just gonna kind of grab a paper towel here, and because I'm switching over to sort of reds and blues, I don't really need I don't need this color anymore. I'm just gonna wipe that up. Just clear my palette off, and then same is true on this side. Just clean that up a bit. All right, I'm gonna keep that green because I feel like there is a little bit of green here. Even though it's a very cool green, I've got a green mixed out that I can add blue to. So that's not a bad thing. Okay. So what I'm gonna do here, what I'm gonna start with are the reds, blues, and greens. And then I'm gonna do the darker yellow shapes, and I think that'll be enough. I'm gonna start with red. So this red is pretty straightforward, like in terms of like how red it is. And I don't actually have that color. Nope. Let me just look through my box O paint. Bit of vermilion. Crimson. I think that's probably that vermilion is what that is right there. That's fine. So I'm not gonna put out any new paint. That's everything I have is out here pretty much. So I'm just gonna pick some of this one up. I'm pretty sure that's a crimson and this is vermilion. And the red that I'm looking at is pretty bright, pretty like standard style red. That's a bit dull. So maybe just more of this, and then maybe some yellow. I don't want to turn it orange. Just want it just a little bit brighter. All right, that's pretty good. Just a touch of water on there, just to keep all that fluid. Oh, reflect some paint. All right. Now, because of the folds, what we're seeing visually those are flowers and like a tree branch, but it's very segmented, it's very jagged where the folds start to happen. So I'm just gonna kind of replicate some of that, especially towards like the top edges where the fan starts to open up a bit. Down towards the center, it kind of compresses a lot. So I'm not overly worried, but I'm just trying to kind of mimic some of that. I don't know. Let me test. Yeah, that's fine. Now there is some information that's happening on the inside of the flower too, but it's so small and sporadic that I'm not too worried about it. Now, one thing I'm doing is I'm thinking about like the directionality of how I'm painting. And so I'm just sort of like following the direction of the fan blades. And that's sort of helping me kind of create that up and down kind of texture that's happening in the image from the fan. That's fine. I'm going to do this big grouping of blossoms here. And it's also maybe giving me a little bit of inconsistency with like that information, which is helpful for kind of creating those interior bits of information that I didn't draw in. My way through. Good. I've got this like branch thing here. Okay, if it breaks apart a bit on me, I'm not seeing the full image anyway, so. I'm changing direction. So. Now over, it's kind of intense over here, but a little bit lighter over there. So I'm just gonna kind of keep my intensity here. Right up onto the noggin of that guy. Pick up some of that color. A bit faded. That's okay. That's pretty good. So now I'm just going to fade that out a little bit, just a little less paint. And you can just extend that just a touch. I'm gonna let that dry for a second. And in the bigger areas, I'm gonna come back in and pick up some of those dark shapes. So I feel like here there's like this stronger dark shape, just like two stripes of it. And then maybe here there's a little bit. So I just want to let that set. I'm going to do one more coat and then move on to the next color. And you can see that the red just covered over the yellow, like it wasn't even there. So it's not like that was an easy decision to kind of make. When it comes time for the blue, you know, the blue is pretty dark all over. And even the green is barely green. It's like a blue green. So I'm going to mix out some of this plus some of this. This is like ultramarine plus thalo. That's probably going to give me the blue green that I want. This might actually be all right here. That's already stuck on my palette. And I think that this is, to me, this is a really important step to kind of help highlight the folds of the fan. So that's why I really want to wait and make sure that it sets up and then come back in and get some of those, just a second pass of this red. I think I'm ready. So it's really just like there's one here. I lost some of that color, so I just want to pick up and mix a new one, just like that. Just a that. It's another one here. Maybe a thinner one there. I'm just gonna sort of let that fade away. I'm gonna do the same thing over here. So just I have a big, thicker shape there. And this one kind of is right there, kind of breaks up, picks back up. And I do think that this could go maybe just a touch darker right there. I'll just get those, let them kind of compress together right there at the end. I mean, and that little bit right there already starts to create a lot of dimension in the fan. And that's what we want. All right, clean my brush off. I just realized my microphone's right next to that, to those cups. All right, so blue. So I'm gonna pick up some of this blue here. That's actually pretty good. Yeah, I think that's pretty good. So I'm just gonna use this blue as is, and then for the green, I'll just mix some green into it. And this blue is really just like here and here-ish. So I got like these like jagged points here. It's a bit thicker. Okay. Maybe there's a little bit of like some small information there. Like inside those flowers, I can pick up. And what I'm seeing is that the blue is kind of like the shadow side of the green. So I'm just gonna pick that same color up for here, where the green is just gonna overlay right up on top of it. So now I'm gonna mix out that green. And that green is definitely in that bluish family. So maybe like right there. I might need a little yellow in there, which is why I kind of left this out here. I can loosen that up, kind of introduce that. And I can work from either pile. If I feel like this is the better color, then this is the color I'll start to pull into. And I think that is. All right, and then green. Sort of solid in there. And maybe there's just like some weird little bits of other stuff in there. It's get on the other side of that blue streak. Just in between those. Yeah. And then I am noticing just like up in these branches, just a very thin amount of like blue. I'm gonna switch out to my finer brush here. And just kind of roll that tip right up in there. And just kind of pick up just some small bits of, there's just, I don't know what those are. Weird little details. Figure I'm here now. I got the paint out, I can do it. I'm not gonna go overboard. I'm not being too specific. I'm not like looking at every single detail. Just enough to sort of indicate what's happening. I do think maybe right there it's a little bit there. And there, and that's it. All right, so before I move on to the next thing, which is the stripes of the yellow part, I really want to let this set up. I really want to make sure that it doesn't bleed out. Everything's kind of where I think it needs to be. My game plan is most of those stripes, I think, visually occur right through here. So I'm going to do a lot of them here, and then they'll just sort of fade off and disappear. Maybe pick up one or two there, maybe a couple here, and then just a couple here. But really, it's this area that's going to do a lot of that lifting, a lot of that heavy lifting for what those shapes are. I'll be using this sharp brush here, this fine point brush, just so I can get a nice single stroke, hopefully. We'll see. In terms of color, I am seeing that it is a kind of shade of yellow. But instead of adding black to it, I think I'm going to add violet just to make it darker. And because I want this to be a bit more fluid with more color than less, I'm going to squeeze out just a bit more yellow onto my palette. Because I feel like I'm having to work that a bit too much right now.
Mark, do you ever use neutral tint? And what's your opinion on the use of that?
It is a great option. And sort of my alternative to say like a real neutral tint is to just add brown to it. That's sort of neutralizing the color.
Like burnt umber?
Yeah, yeah. And generally when I do that, I try to keep sort of within the family of whatever color it is that I'm using. So that burnt umber is in that orange family. So if I'm doing like a blue or something, I'll stick with that. If I'm doing like a green, then I'll pick a sienna because that's a reddish color. So I'm already kind of defaulting towards one of those complement sets. All right, so I do think that this is kind of where the painting can go completely off the rails or not. So hopefully it turns out. And I think that's the exciting thing about painting is like, you know, we could take a picture of this. I mean, I took a picture of it and it's a nice enough picture, but painting adds a whole other element to an image. And it's really about sort of the physicality of painting and sort of the limitations that we have on our dexterity, on our ability to see things, whereas a camera kind of is quote unquote perfect. The painting falls apart at times And that's sort of an exciting proposition. I find it exciting. A lot of people want to kind of push towards photorealism, and that's a great skill to have, but it's not the be-all end-all, especially when it comes to painting. All right, so I think I've stalled long enough. Okay, here we go. So here's some purple, there's some violet in there. I'm just gonna make my pile here. And I just wanna kind of get this closer to what I think it needs to be. Cause I mean, that color is already sort of dull and like not fully saturated. You know, this is fully saturated. But out here, it's been watered down. So I'm just pulling very little of this violet to a lot of yellow, because it's still yellow. And I just want to keep it in that yellow family and just adjust it ever so slightly. I think that might be it. Maybe a little bit more. Like I said, my housekeepers are here. They're just showing up today. And so once they start vacuuming, I'm going to mute it, and then it'll just be kind of like me painting. We only have 10 minutes, actually, so I don't know that that's an issue. Okay, here we go. I've been talking about this. Just trying to see where I'm at, get a sense of what's happening. I sort of drew every other or I drew all the lines in. So I'm just picking up I feel like it's a little heavy on that side. I just want to move that paint towards the center a bit. So now I feel like that's working pretty well. I don't want to go the whole way, otherwise it's going to be too busy. So I'm just going to like start to peter that out. Just, you know, just like give a suggestion. Maybe pick it back up on this one here. Get my palette out of the way. That one, this one. Yeah. I missed that guy. That's working pretty well. I'm just going to hit just a few of these. I don't know which one's which, but I'm going to hope for the best. Like that one. This one. Maybe just a little bit of some indicator down there. And this is why I like having it on the board. I can shift. I'm sorry if it's sort of like you need like Dramamine for this. Do that one. that. I'm gonna do this one, that one. I think this, that, that's. And then just a few of these down here. This right there, this one right there, this one. Let it start and stop, pick back up again. And then just maybe right there. And I think that's it. And so that's enough information to kind of make sense of what that fan is doing. And it looks like it's folded. When I get into the shadow out here, that's going to help sort of reinforce that idea of those folds. And also I'm going to come back in for the handle and make that more intense, because it's like plastic. So it's a very bright and intense yellow, whereas the paper is a little bit more faded. So that's going to help differentiate and clarify what the shape is. Yeah, I think this painting is coming along. I'm excited. This is turning out really well. For your own paintings, really think about all the opportunities that you have to explore color. So stay away from using too much black. I don't even have black on my palette. I mean, I know it's there, but I'm not using it, and neither should you. There's a lot of colors here that are suitable replacements. We're talking about neutralizing colors. We're talking about replacing colors using these darker sort of blues and violets, and even these deep reds, mixing them with like a burnt umber, and you'll be able to get something really, really dark. And that'll kind of allow you a lot of opportunities to find color within your painting. That's a little nerve-wracking, this painting. I'm glad it turned out okay. any last minute questions before we wrap things up? No? Everyone's okay?
I have a question, pest that I am, Bella.
Yes.
Are you basing the folds, where you color in the folds, on what you're seeing? Because we don't see the photo, so I don't know. Or yes. Are you just doing that creatively? Okay.
Well, no, I did copy down some of, like, you can see, I'm just going to pick this up. You can kind of see the pencil marks. So I did indicate some of the information of where those folds are. But for the most part, I was, trying to be systematic about it. And like if I skipped a few or maybe misplaced one, it's not a big deal. Like, it's really kind of the intention of the visual effect. So, yeah. Ryan, did you have a question?
No, I had a comment to force you. Because the neutralizing of the colors, it's always been in my head, but it's never been a thought of mine to not use black. So thank you for opening my mind up to.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. Generally, black is one of those colors, especially early on, that you it's so available and it's so easy to grab, but you should do your most amount of effort to not use black in your painting. Exactly. Mm-hmm. And even throughout kind of the remainder of this course, I'll barely use black. Sometimes I'll dip into it. Sometimes you need it, and that's fine. But usually it can be avoided. So I'm going to hold off on working on this anymore, because I feel like there's other interesting things that I don't want to skip over. So we'll continue this painting on Tuesday next week. And that way we can kind of work all together. Have a great week. And if you have any questions, please, or where did I go? I disappeared. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate to send me an email, message me on Canvas, and I'll get back to you. I'm going to post this photo of where I've left off, so that way we have sort of like a watermark that we can kind of like compare to the progress that we make next week. Other than that, have a great weekend and
see you all Tuesday. Have a great everyday, guys.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
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 Good week.
You too.